Dude, people are sharing information online. Like, I owe it to the community. My name is Patrick Foley, or Patrick 4D, as people know me in the 3D world. Kind of been able to be super specialized in the food world because I've been so active on social media.
Any advice for putting workouts onto social media?
See it as branding yourself, and this is the stuff that's going to get you work. If I'm getting these kind of clients already, and I'm just using this as a hobby, I got to take this seriously. It was forcing me to really be like, okay, what does this stuff look like super close up? It's just proven that being very active on social media kind of pays off and people are watching. Just keep doing it. And then the more you do it, the better you get.
Do you accept the challenge?
I accept the challenge. Every daily I've ever done has amounted to this point. Do we have a timer?
3, 2, 1.
Let's go.
Hey, Patrick.
What's up, man?
All good, man. Happy Friday.
Happy Friday to you.
You know what? I just want to start off by apologizing because today I joined the daily session.
Oh, yeah.
I accidentally paused your songs.
That was you, bro?
It was me.
No. That's hilarious.
I was like, oh, shit. I'm so sorry.
Here she comes to wreck the day.
Dude, you got to let me know when you're in there, man. Wait, what's your name on there?
It's Jamie Bakewell. Perfect, okay, because cool. Bakewell tart is a cake, and I wonder if you've ever made a Bakewell tart.
I don't think so.
Maybe it's a British thing, I don't know. Out of interest, you're not related to Mick Foley?
No.
The wrestler? WWE wrestler? Mankind?
I didn't even know that was a thing.
Are you kidding me? That...
I went to school for film and television. People thought I was like related to the Foley artist guy.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I don't think so.
Patrick, thank you and welcome to the VFX process. Many people will already know who you are, of course, especially in the 3D world, I'm sure. But for those who don't know, can you just give us an introduction of who you are and what you do?
Yeah, my name is Patrick Foley, or Patrick 4D, as a lot of people know me in the 3D world. Most of my workflow is ZBrush at this point, so it should technically be like Patrick underscore brush or something.
Patrick Brush.
Yeah, right. Doesn't hit the same.
No, it doesn't.
That's not gangster. That's not gangster.
I'm a 3D artist that kind of specializes in photorealistic food in the product space, and I've been doing stuff for clients like shaping up menus, baking packaging, you know, the stuff that you'd see on a package that's kind of broken off. Sometimes it looks like photos, but in reality, it's kind of making the switch to 3D. I've been doing that, and I also kind of been able to be super specialized in the food world because I've been so active on social media, primarily Instagram, where I'll make about a reel a day of the process of one of my food creations from start to finish. And I also stream daily on my Discord. So it's just kind of transformed, you know, people that comment things like, oh, this is cool, this is dope, to just people that I interact with on a daily basis. And it's kind of been every day something new. It's been fun.
Just to let you know, like, where we discovered you, of course, social media. You started out doing a lot of cartoons from your childhood growing up. Really creepy. This is like a really...
Grotesque.
Very grotesque, but very intriguing. And it kind of draws you into kind of like the fine details. So you're kind of looking at it on your phone. It's like, is that like, that's so disgusting. Yeah. Just to go back where you started, I know you was in film school. How did it start in the 3D world for Patrick 4D?
Actually, it started back in film school. You're right. I was a director of photography, or going to school for director of photography. I went to SCAD Atlanta. I originally started shooting like these local music videos all the way back in high school. At that time, I didn't know what I was doing. I didn't really know, you know, what shots meant something or how to light subjects. I just kind of did what looked good. And I was like, oh, this looks cool. I don't know why, but that's how it is. And by the time I got to college, I was like, oh, this is why that looked good. It's like, oh, the 3-point lighting. And, you know, I had spent all my money I was making into more camera equipment and lighting equipment. And I was kind of in the rise of the one man band shooters. Midway through college, I got into 3D as a hobby. Cinema 4D was a pretty expensive program, especially back in the day. And I saw that the editing bays for film had them just installed. I don't even know why, but they were on the computers. And I was like, yo, I want to start checking this out. And it turned out to be much easier because you didn't have to rent these really crazy expensive lights, have people all around lifting them for you, potentially breaking stuff on set. And it was pretty enjoyable. So right off the bat, I had a lighting, camera, composition knowledge. The only thing I didn't know was how to like model texture. So I pretty much started in the modeling and texturing game. I wasn't actually doing characters until way later. Like, ZBrush was not part of my skill set or any kind of sculpting for the first at least half of my 3D career. It all started with abstract. And that's what attracted me to even trying to do 3D in the first place. Like, if I would have known back then that I'd be just making like food right now or stuff that you can actually just take photos of. I'd been like, why is that fun? Like I was so in tune with the abstract stuff back in the day. And then I learned ZBrush after I was like, okay, well, there's only so much I can make when I'm bumping two spheres together and like volume modeling and all that. So ZBrush I learned because I kind of ran into a wall. I was like, if I'm going to make anything more than just abstract, I'm going to have to learn this. And then that's where the characters came. And then from the characters, I made, I did this series where I was making cartoon foods come to life, like the Krabby Patty, Purple Flirt from Jimmy Neutron, the Homer Simpson donut. And then from that, I was like, huh, these foods actually look tasty. Like, what if I just started making real foods? And that was the natural progression into the 3D food space, which I realized at the time, coincidentally, not a lot of people, if any, were taking that on as their only niche in 3D. It's usually characters, assets, VFX. It was rarely ever, oh, I'm just doing like photorealistic food as the main thing.
So yeah, you're known as the digital chef. Do you ever order food just so you can touch it?
Hey, food's still warm.
Because your style, it's got very unique elements that come with these shaders and the textures and things. Where do you get your references from?
So I do obviously eat out a lot, go to restaurants, but I rarely like touch the food, like see what it feels like. It's more, I'll take pictures sometimes and I'm like, oh, that's a really dope texture. My main references at this point is just my own work, because there's not that many people who focus on just food, versus back in the day, I was always inspired by like the people who were doing, you know, the abstract environments. But I think because there's a lack of people to take a lot of reference from these days, it's mainly just like looking at photos of food that I've eaten or just Google images. I'm like, oh, what foods can we combine that would be really cool? But when I started accompanying these images that used to be just hero shots into like a secondary, really detailed image, it was forcing me to really be like, okay, what does this stuff actually look like super close up? So it's just a reflection of how much I've just honed in on food.
It's references. People always talk about, you know, when they're creating, especially a 3D model or a 3D piece.
Yeah. A lot of client works, like depending on the client, they'll send me like big shipments of foods.
Oh, really?
For me to actually have, and I'll like be able to look at it really close up. So I've gotten everything from physical things that aren't even out in stores yet sent to me, and I'm able to look at it with like the detail. You know, I've also gotten like really high resolution like folders of assets from every single type of bun, onion, whatever, and I'm like, whoa. And it's like terabytes of storage just like as reference imagery. So, and sometimes there's nothing, it's just like a low res photo of just the food, and usually on the dailies that's all I get. I'm just like going to Google Images, dragging like one or two photos. So when they do get to send me the full thing, I'm like, wow, this is more than I'm used to.
Yeah, for anybody that, you know, wants to join Patrick's Discord, it's a really fun hangout place, and you do this thing called dailies every morning. So you go in, create a piece of work within a few hours, and then you post it as a reel, and that's your morning.
Yeah, every day starts off, wake up, take a shower, then immediately go downstairs to the coffee spot and get a cold brew.
Coffee. Somebody says something about coffee.
Gotta be like the same cold brew every day. And then when I come back to the spot, it's like a mindset thing. Like, because I work from home, like I don't want to make my own coffee. I want to go out and get it. So it feels like I'm entering the workforce when I come back up and I got that coffee buzz. Then I immediately hit the Discord pretty early, around 7-ish a.m. Eastern. At this point, we have people waiting for me to hop on, and the people that are the OGs that I consider my friends at this point. I think it's taught me a lot, because I never know what I'm going to be making until I hop on the Discord. Like, I don't have this list of things. It's really like, all right, what are we making? Even like the official ZBrush live streams that I do for ZBrush, I have no idea what I'm making until I like hop on there. So there's no prep. And I think that's like fun, and it makes the audience feel like they're taking part in it too. I'm like, all right, what do we make? And a lot of times they're like, ooh, what if you did this? And I'm like, ooh, that's good. And they're giving me ideas as I'm sculpting. So by the time I post the reels, it's like, oh, I took part in this. Like, people feel a very nice connection to the piece that we all kind of crafted together. It's a very informal vibe. There's no like, you know, we're all just shooting the shit. Some people have like hopped in there and I'm like, oh, what's up, bro? And they're like, oh, I didn't know we were allowed to talk. And I'm like, dude, we're just chilling. Like, so I think some people think that just like a few people that are able to hop in there, but it's really just like, anyone can come in, anybody can stream. There's no only one person can stream. Like, some people think only I can stream, and it's just, no, anyone who comes in there can share ideas, talk about whatever they want, and it's always a vibe. So I welcome people who join the server to just say what up and also just come hang.
That's a really like a natural fluid way to kind of create something unique, I think. I'm, you know, without overthinking and over planning things and being like limited. Yeah. It's kind of like a really fun playground, really, of you hanging out with people and having their kind of input, and that community vibe, it's pretty special, actually, to be honest.
In a way, especially in this day and age where a lot of people work from home or are part-time from home and part-time commute, it really keeps people on track. And I've had a lot of people reach out to me saying, like, dude, because you're streaming every day and you have this, like, network of people that are always in there, like, I feel, like, more motivated to work by myself every day. And, like, it feels like it's the closest thing to feeling like you're in, like, an office environment. Like, I would consider these people as close as it gets for me to my coworkers, you know?
You mentioned professional work and clients. Do you see your dailies, obviously, it's a routine. Do you see them as, like, a training ground for client work?
Yeah, for sure. I think I've done so many dailies at this point. Like, a daily for me is just picking a new food. And that's why I don't think I've gotten burnt out, because even though I'm making foods every day, they're so different in not only like the structural, you know, models of them, but the texturing, the lighting, all of them end up being so different. So they might as well not all be food renders. I just finished a series where I was kind of going around like the globe and making like national dishes from different countries. These are dishes that you wouldn't see in like a normal Western commercial light. All these different sauces and flavors merging together. And it's like a different type of thinking about textures. So you really have to learn to texture these things in a different way. It's like taking the training wheels off once the client projects come in, because a project comes in and it's like, oh, we want like our cheeseburger just front and center like this. It's like, that's like way more simplistic than the stuff I'm even doing on my dailies. So it's kind of prepped me for a point of not only the detail level, but also I've had many different instances where like clients will hit me up and I'm like, I already made the product for a daily, like back in the day. So I like have it. Obviously, you know, it's not like all these dailies are like optimized for like, you know, to be blown up and high resolution and all that stuff. So I have to rework some of them or just start from scratch. But it's like, yo, I've made this before. It's just proven that posting and being very active on social media kind of pays off and people are watching.
The whole social media world, it's essentially a live portfolio. You know, you're putting out there, you're being vulnerable, especially, I guess, earlier on when you're starting to put work out, because it's always daunting. And I imagine that's where brands have approached you, literally on Instagram is where you post things mostly.
Yeah, you're right. It's like a live portfolio. If anything, it's better than, you know, the way people used to have to rack up like big PDFs and portfolios and decks like that, because, you know, with just social media, I can pin the posts that I want people to see more often, or highlight things, or even show reels, like just a very easy way of showing the process that can reassure clients that are potentially going to hire you for stuff. But most of the time when a client comes, it'll be like a creative director from an agency that have been following my work for a while. And come time they get a project that fits the bill, they're like, oh, I follow this guy that's always posting. This is like no brainer. It's a really like gratifying feeling, because at this point, it's not like me pitching myself and like, oh,
yeah,
can you do the job? It's like,
they know you already.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like, bro, yeah, we've been waiting to work for you, man. It's been great. And it's just like such a nice, welcoming environment and everybody's happy.
What was it like receiving that first kind of brand deal, going from hobbyist?
Yeah, it was a pretty, I'm trying to think if I had like an initial moment in my head. There are a few that stand out. You know, I did one for Adidas for one of their campaigns. And then I did some stuff for Crocs for like one of their winter campaigns. And then it was like Microsoft. This is when I was really starting to think about dropping film altogether. And I'm like, if I'm getting these kind of clients already and I'm just using this as a hobby, I got to take this seriously. And I just gradually stopped doing the film stuff. Because I think at the time I was like, I can do this 3D thing where I'm already using the film principles that I love. But it's just, I can do this in the comfort of my home. It's just everything kind of flowed very naturally. Instagram was the funnel though, always.
I remember seeing like years ago, when you would see a food advert, the imagery was very clean and there would never be any kind of sauce dropped on the side or crumbs. I think that's pretty standard now, isn't it? Where how things have changed from a very touched up, perfect hamburger to a more realistic sauce oozing at the sides, and there's a couple of sesame seeds scattered.
We're going to start seeing more of that, especially as stuff like making this in 3D becomes more apparent. Because like in the film world, you're always kind of fighting, taking the crumbs out, making sure there's no fingerprints, making sure everything's as spotless as you can. Because as perfect as you could ever make it in real life, it's still going to be miles and miles more imperfect than just making the stuff in 3D. So that's why I'm always trying to make things imperfect. One of the bigger brands that were at, they're saying, they use the term flawsome. So we want it to look like flawed, but awesome at the same time. That's why you see things like adding crumbs, because it adds to making it more believable than just, you know, if you shoot something, chances are you're going to want to take the crumbs out. It's going to look a little bit dusty, because even if you cleared up the image in a live action setting as much as you could, it's still going to look photoreal.
What kind of thing do you like creating the most? Like, what kind of food?
Honestly, man, I love making things that have a mixture of hard surface, but also really soft, both in the sculpting sense and texturing. So like, for instance, a chocolate bar that's like breaking apart and it's got caramel coming out. It's like you have the hard surface element to that where it needs to be kind of molded and like shipped out from a factory. But also you break into it and you have this really flowing, organic looking caramel coming out. So stuff that has a little variation of all of it. I like having that. Because then you get to mess with the lighting, the HDRs. Ooh, this highlight is bouncing off of this caramel really nicely. I like that.
What is your kind of tricks to get these specific kind of textures?
Yeah, well, I have different like tips or tricks and tools depending on like what software I'm in. On the texture side, actually, I don't use any external plugins for ZBrush at all. Like, that's part of the reason why I love ZBrush so much, is because just the bare bones program has literally everything you need. Like, I know a lot of people use different programs where they got all these third party plugins, and then just like when it comes down to the bare bones software, it's like, I don't think they'd be comfortable just using that. ZBrush has everything I had ever needed in a program. And I've since developed such a good relationship with those guys. They're like the coolest people. So every time I'm out there, I go say what up to them. And now I was at the ZBrush Summit this year doing a workshop. So ZBrush I use for all the sculpting. And I think one of the harder things to do is, you know, when you're breaking off like a chocolate bar or you're breaking something, making those breaks not look just 3D cut. And so I do a lot of like surface noise masking. So when you cut a piece of chocolate in half, usually breaks it into a separate polygroup. And so when you isolate that polygroup, you can mask it with a noise. And then when you mask it with a noise, you just take that break piece and just kind of extrude it just a little bit. And when you do that, you get something that looks like a natural break in the bar. That mixed with polygroups, you have so much control of what piece of the bar you want to break. And then on the texturing side, I use Octane built into Cinema 4D. I think just one of those things that I do, I don't have to spend too much time texturing at this point because I have just like this library of like hundreds of different food textures. I got like meat, cheese, even like Oreo and Oreo ice cream, stuff that I've made for previous dailies, that's another good thing of making dailies. Every time I make one, I'm like, oh, I haven't really made this texture before. I just save it to my library. And because it's all procedural, it's like the next time I need a Oreo ice cream, I just slap it on there. Or if I need it to be mint chip, I just like slap the Oreo ice cream one and make the absorption color like mint green.
Nice.
And so I spend 90% of my time in ZBrush so that when I get to these other programs, it only takes me, you know, 30 minutes maybe to like finalize the whole thing.
Do you do any kind of like fluid sims to kind of do like syrups and stuff, or is it all just done by hand?
All done by hand. I mean, the most I'll do is like, that's actually a joke we have in the Discord. I'm like so afraid of animation and like simulation. Like, if it's, that's just like, luckily, God forbid, I've been able to be so fine-tuned and just static renders. Boom. Even if it looks like it's like sim or like exploding, it's all done by hand and I don't have to worry about animating. You know, sometimes I'll have to optimize scenes for animation for another team to work on it. But a lot of times what I'll do for like drizzles and stuff is I'll mask it, almost draw on the drizzle and then extrude the mask. And then that'll be its own like object. And then I can smooth it, polish it, export it to Cinema. It's its own object. You can have its own polygroups assigned. So if you want part of the mesh to be one texture and part of it to be another, there's just ultimate flexibility.
Like I said, this is the process of VFX process and everybody's process is different. I imagine you get a lot of messages of people saying, oh, Patrick, you can actually do it like this. And you're always going to get different opinions on how to do it. Or, oh, that's actually the slowest way to do it. What you can really do is...
Yeah, the funniest one I get sometimes, it's pretty rarely, but every once in a while I'll get, bro, you could have just taken a photo of your food. Oh. And I'm like, one, that's a compliment. But two, if I were to have a plate of food in front of me, to get it to be the same quality as the render that I took, I'd have to light it, I'd have to get a camera, I'd have to order the food or make the food, either one. And the point is, doing all that would take me much longer than how fast I've been able to make this stuff at this point. And once it's there, it's there. This food's not going to rot. You know, it's procedural, and if it needs to, you need to switch up the way this looks, you just change the seed, and it just, you have this asset that's always going to be there. So I think in many ways, people think it's not practical, but it's the most practical.
My brother has started exploring like photography like a couple of years ago.
Nice.
If you look on his Instagram, you'll see there's a lot of practical photography of products. So He started to do brand kind of protein bars because he's into the gym and he works out and things. His work kind of really surprised me, actually. And it's incredible, if you ask me. And for someone that's like new to it, he was kind of like a bit shy to maybe post something. But now, you know, he's built his confidence up and he puts it out there. And it's a very vulnerable space to be in. That really goes on to the imposter syndrome of like posting in this world. Any advice for people like putting work out onto social media?
Imposter syndrome is something I never had in the 3D world. Because I went to school for film, I was more stressed about, oh, I hope I do this right because I'm going to school for this. And if I, you know, if I'm still not doing this stuff right, I'm going to look like an idiot. And, you know, that's not a healthy way of thinking either. But at least in the 3D world, I came in there with the mindset of like, dude, this isn't even my main thing. Like, so if I suck, who cares? So it gave me almost more courage to post stuff because I'm not supposed to be good at this. It was just something I was doing for fun. And I think if you can adopt that mindset, and that's why I was able to kind of be posting a lot. And eventually I moved into this place or the place before. And that's when I really started to post like my face more and like process. And at the time I remember thinking like, oh, I don't want to be the guy that's like posting like his setup or this. It just comes off like you're bragging. And then I had like this epiphany where I was like, dude, there's like people that want to see this stuff. And if you can get past the whole like, oh, I don't want to be seen as someone who's just like showing off or this or that, see it as branding yourself. And this is the stuff that's going to get you work. Like, is Oreo or Pop-Tarts bragging by like coming out with ads showing the product? No, nobody thinks like that. It's like you're just branding your skill set and like the shit that you do. So as long as you don't get in your head about like, oh, what if people don't think it's good? Like if you ain't got haters, you ain't popping.
That's
so
true.
I think you want to have a dialogue in the comments. That means you're reaching people. So if you just come up with the mindset that that's going to happen regardless. And if it does happen, that means you are targeting the right people. Just keep doing it. And then the more you do it, the better you get.
What about criticism online? Like what kind of stuff have you ever received?
Dude, I am so lucky to say that there's been next to no criticism.
Amazing.
Especially in the food world. Like I've got, like the main thing was like, okay, maybe a couple of people have been like, oh, you could just take a photo
take
of
a
that.
Photo.
And I think back when I was doing the characters, there might be a couple of people are like, if I tried to make like a rapper or sculpt, which humans are so hard, someone may have been like, dude, this looks nothing like him. But
that's the point.
Other than that, like it's been like a very smooth ride as far as the critique world goes. And that's something that, especially compared to the film world, there's so many more times where like DPs can come off a little bit like pompous or, you know, you're on these big sets and people can develop egos. But in the 3D world, I was like, dude, people are sharing information online. Like the only reason I have a career is because people gave out free YouTube tutorials. And that's why at the beginning of my career, I was doing a lot more like YouTube stuff and Skillshare stuff. Cause I was like, I owe it to the community. And I guess my version of that now is like Discord streaming every day, even though it doesn't seem like I'm doing like tutorials, I'm still making this stuff. People can see the process. Yeah, dude. It's just been like this. I think it's been very smooth. I can't complain.
You do workshops, especially at like ZBrush Summit and things like that. Mm-hmm. Any plans to kind of do more training and selling things like asset packs and things? Or is that not something that you're going towards?
I was actually on the asset pack game for a little bit. I have a site that's still up where I'm selling stuff called P4D.store. And I have all three of my like HDRI packs that I hand shot, like cloud, VDB packs, fire, smoke. And that was a little bit more when I was more of a generalist. As far as like learning content, I do have like long-term plans to come out with like a master class of some sort, which will be in a good sense, like you take it and you'll be able to make any food you want in 3D. So, but the reason why I haven't even started making it and just planning vaguely on it is because I want to make sure I truly mastered this stuff. Cause I don't want to be coming out with this content all the time. And then I'm like, oh, well, I wish I would have like teach them to do that a different way. Cause sometimes I'll go back the earliest Skillshare classes. I was using like very old versions of Cinema. I was using the physical renderer, stuff that's obsolete now. And I'm like kind of cringed looking at it. So I want to make sure everything's just like sealed shut. Like I get it. I also am just, you know, ready to kind of come out with something like that. Cause I think it takes a long time to kind of be that comfortable making everything. I'm starting to get to that point where any food possible, I'm like, easy, got it, boom. But once I get to that point, I'll start making that.
Like you say, you look back at the ways that you used to do things on like Skillshare and it's kind of obsolete or there's new ways of doing things.
Mm-hmm.
How do you kind of stay on top of or create something that will last in a world where there's new tools coming out all the time to like do this for you or automate this? I guess, is there a sell-by date on things like that?
Yeah, I think it really just comes down to when we say what's relevant, if it teaches you to make something pretty fast and it looks right, then it's relevant to me, at least in the world of creating this kind of content. Because we live in a day and age where, you know, there's a lot of stuff's more accessible. People are coming out with new this every day. Even these softwares that we use all the time are having new updates all the time. I think if you feel like you need to be at the very top, you know, version of every software, this technique 24/7, like, you're not going to be happy, because you're just, it's like, I just learned this. Oh, a new thing came out. I got to like relearn. And it just doesn't make sense after a certain point. It's like, I was using, you know, a 2021 version of Cinema 4D and Octane like a month ago. And I just now rebuilt this whole system. And part of the reason that was because I had client projects in which I'm actually sending design files over. And with those client projects, when I update the softwares, the textures don't look the same. And so I was kind of trapped in learning or using old versions of software. I'm now current on every software. You know, I got the new workstation here, which has been great. Everything's like sped up now. And so, you know, I was able to start building like a huge clientele network and like become a prominent figure in on social media, all with just using old versions of softwares. So it doesn't matter if you're on like the very oldest or the newest or whatever. That would be like a mental block if you think you have to be on the very newest version all the time.
No, it makes sense. Absolutely. I mean, there's gross ups and then there's like a Patrick 4D gross up. Like, because when you look at it for a while, you kind of just curl up and go, oh, that's so.
Yeah, I think that's why it's fun, because it's like you look at cartoons. I think a lot of SpongeBob stuff.
Thank you for your patronage.
SpongeBob had a style that they would whip out every once in a while. And it was like these really grotesque, like still frames that were so crazy.
Ren and Stimpy springs to mind for me.
You stupid idiot! We can't just wander around like idiots!
Which I did those guys too.
Of course, I've seen those,
So any kind of gross up you can imagine, Flapjack, Ren and Stimpy, SpongeBob, like I probably did them all at one point. I think the first character I even tried to make that was like a gross up was Salad Fingers. Even though his face is very simple, it's like an oval and then cut out for the eyes, I was making them in a way before Maxon even acquired Pixelogic or ZBrush. They didn't have any sort of remesher, so I could like make these shapes and cut out things, but they would be so dense under the hood. And I was like, yo, even for this very simplistic Salad Fingers guy, it just looks, it's hard on my computer making these things. So I had to learn ZBrush and just get into better things like topology and doing stuff that way, polygroup separating textures. There's like a pureness to the way they're drawn, to where you can't get that level of detail that you can in 3D. It's just like, it leaves so much to your imagination. Even when they're trying to portray someone as kind of gross, or they have like a boil and like maybe three hairs sticking out, what does that look like if this guy was in real life? And so when you have the ability to use like displacement maps to really make their skin super acne ridden or really bumpy or really like, you can just mess them up. I remember that classic look of like ruining someone's face. I just used this one image of like this pizza texture that I used as a displacement map for all of them.
Oh, God.
And it was like, nobody knew. Everyone's like, how do you make these crazy dope? And I'm like slapping like a medium resolution pizza texture on their face in the displacement channel. And everyone's like, holy shit, like this is crazy. Like at this point, everything's kind of procedural, but at the time I was just making shit that was so bad under the hood, but it looked fine. So who cares? You know, as long as people are like wowed and is going viral, like nobody really cared.
I've got a question here for something I wanted to touch on. Like, yeah, you're in the 3D world. You do CG work all the time. Any thoughts on printing them out in 3D, painting them and having physical versions? Ah, why have I not seen that?
The burger. There? Have you seen that before?
Not the physical one.
Dude, check this out.
I don't want to break anything, Patrick, so I apologize.
Oh, you're good, bro. Check this out.
Oh, my God.
This was made in ZBrush, textured in ZBrush, and it was actually 3D printed and printed the textures right on the model.
Oh, really?
And you can take all these pieces out, like the eyes and stuff, and just pop them back in. And the tongue is, like, so grotesque.
That is so cool, man.
Yeah.
That is so cool.
This was a fun one.
What was the reason for doing that? Was it just a bit of fun?
Pretty much. That was when I was scheduled to do a workshop at the ZBrush Summit. The guys over at ZBrush, Paul Gabory, connected me with these guys called Mamaki. They have this like technology, and this is where I'm not even a pro at any of this. I'm just the guy that was making this stuff. That's like the Fortnite burger. And we just went through some of my old work, and they're like, ooh, it'd be so fun if you did one of like these sandwiches or this Fortnite burger with the tongue. And so I just optimized my scene. You know, it's a fully poly-painted mesh in ZBrush, and it looks pretty much identical to that. And they were like, yeah, we can 3D print this and just project your poly paint onto the mesh. And I didn't even know that was a technology. You can take the bun off and the bun texture's all the way there. And like,
really?
It's really cool.
I thought, is it a hand-painted thing? But there's a technology to put textures onto a 3D print.
Yeah, not hand-painted. Yeah, it's crazy. And it's like heavy. It's got weight to it, which is why I was holding it.
I could tell, yeah. I could tell as you was picking it up. Like,
I couldn't even tell you how they did that. I should have asked more questions when I was there. But, you know, I was doing so much when I was there, and we linked up, and then they shipped this back to me. And I was so pumped when I got it. It's
cool,
it's
man.
Sweet.
That is so cool.
I think I'm supposed to do more stuff with them and go to their studio up in North Georgia and kind of do more collabs with them. So,
what about your own serial?
Ooh.
A Patrick 4D serial where all the pieces are kind of like little 4s and D's, and there's some like marshmallows, like, you know, Lucky Charms type
right.
thing.
That'd be so cool. Sometimes I think back and I'm like, damn, it's still so early on. Like, I've only been doing this food stuff for like a year and a half. And in that year, it's like I've made the connections with like Maxon, ZBrush, and all these guys. I was doing part of the tour with the design and animation tour with the Maxon guys. This last year, 2023, was like the year where I went from like just online stuff to showing up places, like people like knowing me from social media. And it's still so early on in this game. And I got ideas like collabing with real chefs maybe and doing like, who makes the dish better, me or the guy who actually makes it? Or
cool, man.
But
it's early days.
Yeah, dude, the sky's the limit.
Something to wrap up on. Now, I know that you do dailies every day. This is a mini daily, so I apologize if you've done enough dailies and enough work today.
This is the test to see if I can actually make stuff or if I'm just using Midjourney every day.
This is why we've done it.
Uh-oh.
There's no pressure, and it doesn't need to be rendered, of course, but it is a logo of ours. The challenge is taking that image that we've got and turning it into some kind of cake or a biscuit or something fun that you can do within 10 minutes. Do you accept the challenge?
I accept the challenge, and this is every daily I've ever done has amounted to this point.
I don't know if you've done a 10-minute one before, but this is, just keep it simple. Ooh. Have a bit of fun.
Do we have a timer?
We've got a timer here. 3, 2, 1, let's go.
Okay, so I have an alpha here, it looks like. I'm gonna drag with like a plane and turn this up here. I'm actually gonna extrude it as a mask, so let's see.
Oh, did you do the pen grab, Patrick? Sorry. You know the special pen grab?
You grab the pen, here we go.
Yeah,
we'll grab the pen.
Yeah.
Boom.
Wicked, nice.
Boom. Let's go.
Sorry, I've just wasted 10 seconds there.
All right, let's go here. Let's grab this alpha here. Just gonna kind of eyeball this, something like that. Boom. Maybe just boost the mask a little bit. All right, we have the 3D extruded mesh. So I'm trying to think what we need to do here. Ooh, what would be the best? Okay.
We have got 1 minute 40 gone.
Okay. Could be worse, could be worse.
There we go. It's looking like a snack already, I can imagine.
Yeah, I'm trying to think of like what...
I'm a fan of those. Have you seen those chocolate-covered pretzels?
Yeah, right. All right, so I'm going to go... I think I will go with the pretzel idea. So I'm creating a new layer here.
Right.
And I'm going to use this top layer to sprinkle salt.
Ooh, salty pretzel. Mm-mm.
Yes.
These pretzels are making me thirsty.
So I'm going to go here, remesh this, just take some of the stuff out. So come time I do redistribute salt on this thing, it's not too dense. We're also going to hide this. So in ZBrush, you call this nano mesh. So I'm just going to go insert nano mesh, polygroup all. Create different like salt flakes, and then we're gonna go and randomly distribute these. Take the placement off, maybe randomize the size, the rotation, and what's cool about nano mesh is you can actually edit this mesh on the left while seeing it on the right, so you can like maybe do something like this.
Ah, so that's a close-up of the sprinkles, essentially.
Of the salt, yeah. Which is also being randomized by...
cool, man.
By the other parameters. So when I jump out of this...
Of course. That's so cool.
When I jump out, we actually have something that looks a little bit more...
Yeah.
kind of like salt. And the cool thing about this is I can still move the bottom of the mesh without disrupting the salt. So I can like move this stuff down. The salt is not actually being affected. It's just kind of moving along the mesh, so I can move this stuff down. So we got that. We can hop back over real quick to this other mesh and maybe highlight. This is the dope thing about polygroups. I can select just this portion and like grow the selection. Maybe polygroup that, mask it.
5 minutes gone. 5 minutes left. And it's looking tasty.
Like that?
Oh, yeah.
Looking nice. All right. And then maybe add some drizzle or something.
Oh, Is it? I've seen on the videos where you just literally draw with a, with your Wacom any kind of...
The mask curve pen. So I can just go boom, boom, boom. And the cool thing about this is it sees the height of the, the mesh. And then I can just grow a mask from that. And then when I grow the mask, I can go subtool, extract, accept, polish.
Oh, man. Oh, that you make it look so easy, Patrick. You make it look...
And we have some sort of, like, pretzel here.
Hell yeah.
Oops, maybe a little bit higher resolution. There you go. And then when I take the contrast down, you can get from... Looks a little bit jaggedy over there to something that looks really nice and smooth.
Nice.
Steve,
look at that.
And then it kind of drizzles just like that. And I'm trying to think what else. Like any...
I think we've got our new logo. I think we've got a new
Food logo.
Yeah. Then send us an invoice after this, Patrick.
So I'm going to mask this part again. Feather the mask. How much time we got?
We are... It's 6 minutes 30 have gone.
Okay, cool. Perfect. Yep. Last thing. We have here this unmasked portion. This new feature in ZBrush 2024. You can use the maxon noises, which are like just the ZBrush noises. So I can mix the noise off. And then I can take the scale here, mask by noise. And then just do like something like that to give it a little bit of texture at the bottom, maybe.
Oh, nice, man.
And I think that should be like, for the most part, it. We got a little bit of stuff going on here.
Awesome, man.
Just inflate that together. Let's kind of collapse this stuff here. Oops.
Patrick, you know your beans. It's wizardry. This is unfolding before our eyes.
This is every day. This is like every day doing this stuff. You get so used to it. And the cool thing about once you collapse these salt particles, when you can use the something like the move topology tool, you can actually move them individually without distorting them at all. You can just move them. You're like, oh, I don't like this one. You can move this here. And then you have all that there. And then
does that snap to surface? Is there any way to, like, wait, if you move a salt part?
Yeah, I think there's ways you can snap to surface. This one is not specifically. You can just kind of move it across. But there's ways in, like, using curves that you can to smack this stuff to the surface for sure. And I think that's it.
Awesome. Well, you've got 2 minutes. It's 8 minutes and 15 seconds up. There's a question. When is done? When's the icing on the cake?
My version of done is just, I think about like, oh, what is the Instagram frame going to be? And like, is the average person going to be able to see, oh, that looks fake or whatever? And if they can't, I'm done. I did my work. I don't spend too much time kind of overthinking that stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, wait, how much time? Are we done? I'm just going to make a plate. I'm going to make a plate.
Oh, a plate. Okay.
We'll do circle.
Okay. We've got 1:15 left.
Easy. There we go. Let me go boom.
Do you not have a library of Patrick's plates that exist in a cupboard somewhere that you
Dude, you think I would, but dude, I have this weird thing where I feel like I'm cheating if I don't remake everything from scratch. Other than like, you know, the textures and then finessing them from there. But like, at least with the models, I gotta make them from scratch.
Nice.
Maybe something like that.
Favorite type of plate to model, Patrick, go.
Bowls are fun. I think a good ramen bowl's pretty good.
You've got 15 seconds left. Shall I do a countdown? 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Patrick, whack him pen down. That is the complete task.
Senslav's pen.
Okay.
Recently switched over.
Nice. Shout out. That was so fun, and I hope you enjoyed it. We have got a very quick couple of images that you need to tell us. Is it a 3D render, or is it a photograph of a cake?
Okay.
Here we go.
Cake or fake?
first one.
Okay. This is tough. I think real.
It is cake. Correct, Patrick. Next one is it a cake or is it a fake?
Fake.
If you're saying fake. Yeah, that is fake. The next one, is it a cake or is it a fake?
Fake.
It is indeed fake. Absolutely. To me, it was the drizzles on the side, but...
Yeah, something with even the floor.
That is fake indeed. And the next one, is it a cake or is it a fake?
That's cake.
That is cake. And the next one is it a cake or is it a fake?
It's like Midjourney. That's fake.
Fake. It is fake. Yeah, it is very, it does look very Midjourney, doesn't it? Number six is it a
real
cake or is it a fake? That is cake. You know your cake when you see it. Yeah. Patrick. And the next one is it a cake or is it a fake?
That's real.
That is indeed cake. Patrick, you're good, man. Of course. I was expecting nothing less. That is number seven. Number eight, is it a cake or is it a fake?
That is real.
That is, in fact, that's a fake.
That's fake?
That's fake, yeah. Ooh. I don't know who did it.
That's good.
Number nine is it a cake or is it a fake?
That's cake.
That is cake. We got one left. Is it cake or is it fake?
Fake.
That is fake. It's something about the strawberries. You can tell the difference there on those strawberries compared to the real ones. There's a lot of detail going on in a real strawberry.
The cake and the cake texture in the middle looks a little bit like carpet. But they're getting close, man. It's hard to nail food, so it's like, these are good.
Patrick, I just want to say that was hella fun and I could literally hang out, which I will be. I'll be in the dailies.
Yeah, man. Please, keep pulling up.
I won't pause the music again. I'm sorry. And I'll get involved. Okay.
Oh, yeah. Dude, thanks for having me. This is great. It was really fun, like, chopping it up and getting to be on this. Like, it's always fun to be able to talk about, like, the history and where I'm headed and just other stuff about what people are doing and even fun activities like that. That was the first time I did, like, a game like that. That was really fun.
I see. Awesome, man. Well, thanks, Patrick. I'm really glad you enjoyed it. Talking about the future, anything going on that you... Any news? Anything that you want to tell us before we jump off? Anything going on?
Any news? Let's see. Yeah, I mean, this year, be ready and on the lookout for stuff to be like on the store shelves, which, you know, everything that I can post, it'll be on my Instagram and just stuff that you can look out for in different stores. I know I got a few projects that are dropping soon, which that's a new wave for me, just being usually it's digital, being a 3D artist, but to have this stuff actually on brand shelves is awesome. Masterclass news will be, you know, that's a long-term thing, so I can't promise that very soon, but you will hear about it. Any news or updates, it'll be on my IG.
For anybody who doesn't know, if they've been living under a rock in the 3D world, we'll put all the handles and all that stuff, of course. You've got a massive following, and I just want to say thank you. That's been an absolute pleasure, Patrick. Really great to meet you, and we'll catch up soon, man.
Likewise, man. I appreciate it. Thank you, guys.
Take it easy, man. Bye, Patrick. And Steve, say goodbye.
Bye,
Take
Patrick.
It easy.
Hey, the goat.
See you later, dude. Easy, man. Bye, Patrick.
See ya.